welcome everybody to a brand new episode of Attack on Show. I'm Robbie.
I'm Jay Marsh.
That's sticking with it?
Yeah, I'm going to stick with it.
All right. We got an exciting episode. Season 2 is continuing on. This is now episode 4.
Sure.
Once we figure out how many episodes there are to a season, we're going to be on to season 3 before we know it.
Sure.
We've got a little brief movie news segment we'd like to show you guys today. There's some exciting news on The Mandalorian.
I wonder if that's because it's pre-holiday. And I mean that in all seriousness. I think a lot of these studios are kind of scaled back a little.
They know Deadpool's coming out. They're just stopping everything.
You think that's what it is? And there's like nothing else coming out right now. So.
Speaking of nothing else coming out, we have a fantastic trailer, The Farm. You guys stick around for this. You're going to really like
it. It's fantastic. Yeah.
And then on Binge-worthy, we're going to take a look at Netflix's original series, Sabrina, not the Teenage Witch.
Right.
No, they got rid of the puppet cat.
They did.
And then on Beacon Rewind, we have a fantastic movie from Dennis Quaid, which is called Frequency. It's a fantastic film under the radar. I think you guys want to stick around.
Absolutely.
You'll like this one. And then we're going to jam out on I Miss My MTV to Blur by Mo.
Absolutely.
I don't know. It's like Mo on YouTube.
It is. It's, yeah.
Fantastic, everybody.
You're gonna want Mo.
Everyone, this is
Attack on Show.
Some exciting movie news coming out. We'll cover that first. We've been tracking The Mandalorian.
We have.
Disney Plus streaming that is coming out. They've actually cast now The Mandalorian, which I actually thought it was already cast.
I was under that understanding.
To see this news.
You know, I'm going to say it kind of threw me as well. I don't know if this is an announcement. From my understanding, for this was supposed to be the premier show of the launching of Disney Plus. So for it to just now kind of announce
cast
that,
its lead.
I was you know, first quarter next year was my understanding for Disney Plus.
I mean, when you think of the filming, the Mandalorians walk around in a mask, so I'm sure a lot of the principal filming is already done, so they really just have to film the scenes without the helmet. Pedro Pascal from Game of Thrones is cast as the lead. Fantastic. You couldn't get ahead in Game of Thrones,
no.
So... Honestly, fantastic actor. I think this is a fantastic casting. He's got the cool voice.
No, you can't die yet. You haven't confessed.
The cool sound. I think seeing him in this role is really going to pay off. I'm excited for what Disney is starting to do with the Star Wars universe.
Absolutely.
Hopefully this is the turn that we're all crying for
since
the Disney purchase.
We kind of talked. We'd like to see an end to the movies for a while. Make them a little more event oriented. I don't need 2 or 3 a year or one or I really don't need 1 a year. I'd rather have 1 every 2 or 3 years.
Make it a big deal
and then go back to, you know, some opportunities that are going to take place. Speaking of that, Rogue One, the actor from Rogue One
they're going to create a prequel series, another live action series on Disney Plus with the Cassian character of Rogue One. So that's very exciting.
That's it. To me, that's just as exciting. You know, there's a significant reference to the things he has done for the rebellion and kind of the dark and dirty work that
Him just offing the guy at the beginning.
Absolutely.
Calm down. We'll be all right.
The stuff that he has had to do for the rebellion. It will be interesting.
Absolutely. It could play into a very dark, very adult type show that I think everyone's kind of looking for. Disney Plus is actually looking like it's going to contend. Just with what it has. We have two Marvel miniseries that they've also discussed taking place around Loki and then Scarlet Witch, both separate but in the same universe.
Those are miniseries, so I think it's just going to be a select number of episodes
Six episodes, something like that.
A storyline and then done. So that'll be nice. It'll be a fixed set and then get your fill and move on. I mean, I think it's fantastic. The Marvel Universe just keeps expanding.
And I think what you're going to see is this is kind of going to eliminate some of those origin movies. Because you have Disney Plus, where they could talk about this character, and then, you know, next year or the year after that, you're seeing him launched or an additional character in some of these movies. These sub-characters don't need, they can...
Yeah, we don't need I would take a Loki film, but Loki series,
if you're a Loki series, you're probably going to get more screen time than you would ever get out of a Loki film.
Yeah, so a little bit of news.
Absolutely.
I'm very hungry, so I want to kind of keep this episode moving.
Yes.
So let's move on to preview, review, and take a look at The Farm. So
fantastic.
You're going to check this
yummy.
Out.
Wouldn't it be much nicer to stay at home?
Yes, it would.
I'm tired and I don't want.
I know where that leads.
You just put your head on my lap.
Yeah, exactly. Just here. I'm naked.
I'm sorry. I've taken a lot of road trips and I never end up in the middle of nowhere. Oh, that looks so good. I'm so hungry right now. She ate the meat.
Hello?
Welcome.
This is why you don't let vegans make movies.
No, this is exactly why you don't let vegans make movies. Worst bed and breakfast ever.
What the fuck's going on here?
I'd like to know too.
Don't.
Alex!
Oh.
Deja vu.
Guess here and say that, you know, this is not going to be featured in a Happy Meal at McDonald's.
I imagine this is not a Christmas release date.
No. And it's, you know, maybe it's signed to the Beef Carver, you know, there'll be a Happy Meal there, but not McDonald's.
Hey Hollywood, I don't care what your messaging is, I'm still going to go to McDonald's and grab a burger.
I'm going to get a triple cheeseburger with no pickle, because that's how I eat it.
Well, that's the farm, everybody. Choose for yourself if you're excited to see it.
And if you are, you're a really messed up person. Yes. You need to go talk to somebody.
After you purchase a ticket here, just look at your insurance and see if therapy's included.
God, man.
You want to go on to
binge-worthy? Yeah, binge-worthy sounds... God.
Listen up now. This is serious.
I was just wondering,
No!
I don't feel so good.
No. God, really? Nice. Why am I all turned on right now? Is that wrong? I don't know, guys. I don't know.
Switching gears.
Please.
We're going to take a look at Netflix's original series, The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina the Teenage Witch. This series has seen some different reincarnations throughout the years. Obviously, you had the teenage series with Melissa Joan Hart, the new animated series.
Which went one completely way. Yes. And let's just say we went and swung the complete other direction.
Yes. Netflix has taken this character into a complete dark...
Hail Satan.
...age. Yes.
My name is Sabrina Spellman.
Hail Satan. Goatman. This series, it's... I tell you what, I told people I was watching it. And I got kind of laughed at for watching a Sabrina.
And I got him started on this. Yeah. There's a rarity amongst us, but I got started watching it, and I was like, you got to watch this.
This is not a show just for children, teenage group. Honestly, I think some of it is almost too... I think there's almost too much graphic stuff
There is definitely graphic stuff in this. You grown up
before my very eyes. You're a rebel, Spoon.
But I do have to give some credit to the fact that they have taken... what could be an incredibly sexually charged show and pretty much eliminated that portion out of it. And now, on the other side of it, it's an incredibly fun... yet intense.
If you're fans of, Buffy back in the day or Angel... you're going to love this series.
Well put. That's what I kept thinking.
I was a huge Buffy the Vampire fan. Huge Angel fan, especially in its last season. Also played Angel at Warner Brothers
he
Studios.
Did.
So
he did.
A little gig there. So yeah. If you need a
is
stunt
that a
double for SWAT.
Is that a gratuitous plug?
No,
he's not in SWAT. He's in SEALs.
Whatever.
Yeah, no one really cares.
The gem of the show is Kiernan Shipka.
Yes.
I tell you, that's a great find for the series.
She grew up on Mad Men. If you watch Mad Men, if you're a fan of Mad Men, she grew up on Mad Men. And you could see it there. Like, her acting chops are definitely honed for this. It's fantastic.
She carries the series very well. It centers around her. And if you don't know the premise of Sabrina, she's turning 16 on the show. And by her 16th birthday, she's born of a warlock and human, so she's half witch, half human, and at the age of 16, she must pick whether to go full witch and go to the, you know, the private witch school and leave everyone that she's grown up with behind, or no to that and not be able to use the magic and then, you know, embrace her human side. But there's this whole backstory that while watching a series, you're trying to find out they really want her to attend this school, and you don't really know why.
And there's a reasoning for it, and you don't know why. And the interesting part that I really enjoyed, if you're an original watcher, all the characters are there. All the, from Harvey the boyfriend.
Good night, Harvey.
They're all there, but playing much different.
Much darker,
serious. Much
roles.
Darker roles.
Minus the puppet cat. Even the cat is cool on this series.
Right, even the cat is cool, and you kind of get an idea of who the cat is. Originally, it's a very quick scene, but and I think it's in episode one where the cat's introduced, and Salem
spirit,
is introduced, and you kind of, it's very cool how it's done.
Yeah, it's
just
the familiar.
And I came.
Yes.
The show centers around Sabrina having to make this decision, and what is she going to do? And it really dives into her, you know, whether or not she's going to be able to say goodbye. She's got this boyfriend that she's in love with. She's got a really good close group of friends at school. It deals with, again, I hate to keep saying Buffy the Vampire Slayer, but it really deals with the issues that
the battle of good versus
teenage,
evil
and
in
the
a decision.
Teenage everyday
Absolutely.
Life.
Yep. Balancing the two. Whoever's casting for the show, I think, does an incredible job, and it really, really shows. In,
especially Belky.
Yes.
Belky is back.
Oh my
from
God,
Perfect
is he fantastic?
Strangers. How great. And he looks great.
He does. He looks really good. He plays an incredible character.
When you have like Paul Reiser popping up in Stranger Things, you have all these 80s actors kind of come up, and they've aged, like Matthew Modine in season one. They aged a lot. But when Belky popped up in this, I was like, man, Belky's
it
kind of,
it's, it
doing
It actually
well.
Threw me for who it was first. I had to go look, and it kind of blew my mind because he does look really good. So all of that dancing, and we can see what he turned into. A principal.
But it's a very great show, very cultural. It really dives into everything that's happening in today's world.
It
and,
really
and
does.
It actually
yes.
hits it head on. And I tell you, this is not a show just for teenage children. I would recommend, actually, if you're a parent and your child is watching it,
you may
I think
watch
you
it
should
first.
Watch it with them.
Rise!
The Church of Satan, believe it or not, has actually sued the
yes.
producers and creators in the show over the use of a particular...
Of the goat face.
Of the goat face and the particular use on this, and I mean...
I mean, what show is not complete if you're not getting sued for using a goat face statue? So
I mean, absolutely. Again, I don't have a goat face statue at home. And I don't know if I'm ever going to have one. And that means nothing to you.
I don't know, after watching the show. So definitely check out Sabrina
Please.
The Chilling Adventures on Netflix. Definitely worth the watch. We'll move on to, is it Be Kind Rewind next?
Sure.
What are
Be
we doing?
Be Kind Rewind. We're doing Frequency.
Well, you just said that. Okay, on this week's episode of Be Kind Rewind, we're going to go back to a movie that came out in 2000. It's Jim Caviezel.
Correct. Jesus himself.
Jesus himself, ladies
yes.
and gentlemen. And Dennis Quaid. Movie's titled Frequency. It's a fantastic film produced from the Emmerich brothers, Toby and Noah.
Yes.
Noah is actually a well-known actor. He's in The Americans. He was in The Walking Dead mm-hmm. episode. He's actually in Frequency.
Darren, it's your dad's old ham radio.
He plays the friend here. But it takes place in present day. Jim Caviezel is a police officer. His father died in the past. He was a fireman. And the Northern Lights are happening. And Jim Caviezel finds this old ham radio that
Correct.
His dad
yes.
used to use all the time. Well, when he plugs it in, he can communicate with his dad in the past who always played on the ham radio.
But how could it be?
I don't know. But we got to be talking off the mother-son spot of all time.
The previous internet, as it's called in the...
Yes.
In the movie. So it's interesting because, you know, you have these time jump movies or, you know, they often fail. I think Frequency plays with the timeline changes very well. It's very cool tricks. Like, Jim Caviezel will ask his dad, you know, I need to get something from you. Hide it where no one will ever find it for the next 20 years. And, like, the dad finds this loose board and says, all right, puts it in there and hides it and says, go look underneath the board. And
it's in! I got it!
Wow. it's a great murder mystery movie.
It is. It's exactly what it is.
I did not know anything about it in theaters. I came across this movie on DVD on a whim to watch it, and I was blown away.
Mm-hmm.
It's a smart movie. It's well written. It's a murder mystery where basically murders are happening now during the son's timeline. And there was a serial killer in the dad's timeline in the past. And basically what happens is through them talking, this isn't a major spoiler, but the son tells the dad, hey, you're going to die in this fire. And then because he lives, well, it changed the night he was supposed to die. And now the mother is murdered from the serial killer.
Prior to this point in time, somewhere in the past, the timeline skewed into this tangent, creating an alternate 1985.
And this serial killer just went away in the 70s and now is kind of popping back up in the son's timeline. So they're trying to solve this, who the serial killer is in both timelines.
Yes.
It does a great job. The acting in it is superb. I love Dennis Quaid films. I think he picks his films he's very smart.
Would you argue that the 2000s, early 2000s was his peak?
Yes, because The Rookie was fantastic. Yes. That was a great movie. And this I think is up there as well. This is the movie, if you like those films that keep you guessing to the very end, not knowing
it
what's going to happen.
Holds up. It does. It really holds up time-wise because it wasn't too dependent on anything for that genre.
Other than Yahoo. Remember?
Yes,
The big joke in the movie is the guy should have invested in Yahoo.
Completely forgot about that. Yes.
But it does hold up. It does. It's not too dark, but it will keep you guessing. Just when you think you know where this movie is going to go, like most stereotypical timeline movies, it goes there, but then it goes a step further, and it just really keeps you guessing. I love the dual timeline parallel and the way that they come together every night and talk about what happened to try and figure out what to do tomorrow. It's fantastic.
This
is a very well-written movie. If you're into like a murder mystery movie that you want to keep guessing, I highly recommend Frequency.
Myself as well.
For a movie night. You as well?
Yeah.
We agree?
We do. Twice now.
You're
kind of
by that time. Was Neil Patrick Harris on your mind? So definitely check out Frequency. And are we to the end of the show?
Oh my god, no, we got
I miss my TV. That's what I mean. We're ready for some music. This is the easy part.
That's super easy part. So
I miss my MTV. Yes, we're at the end of the episode, everybody. If
he
you're still watching
the entire MTV theme song while that was down.
I always do.
Yeah.
If you've made it this far, you're the one. So we'd like to introduce you to an artist called Mo. His song title is Blur. So check it out. It's a very cool jam.
Yeah, absolutely. Or is there something in the air we breathe? Cause I'm feeling dizzy, dizzy. How was the party? Was it treating you right? Was that I could be the but I'm under the bed. Trapped in the blur, started out the way I wanted, but I swear now. Let me out, I'm lost in the words. Too much in my head, I should have seen the bad signs. I wanna tell you everything will be fine, but I'm afraid that it's a waste of your time. Let me out, I'm lost in the words. Don't know how I think you're trapped in the blur. Again, great song, great beat, and yeah.
I think it's a great combination. I like the raspy voice. I do like that raspy vocal sound with the beat behind it. It's very cool. There's also some very cool acoustic versions of that online. Definitely worth checking out.
Now, that changed my mind a little bit. We did have an opportunity to see it, and I did enjoy the acoustic version.
Yeah. So definitely, everybody, we're through an episode. Make sure you click the like, subscribe.
Oh, are we still even doing that? It doesn't matter. Yeah, okay.
I'm saying it every episode. 203, buddy. Definitely make sure, share on your Facebook wall. Tell your friends. Smash their face into the computer if they're not watching it. We need views.
Tell your mom.
Does anyone watch stuff on computers anymore?
No, nothing. No.
Everybody, this is
Attack on Show.